So welcome to the webinar. My name is Brian Fox. I'm a CFD engineer here with Flow Science. And today I'll be presenting a discharge analysis of a piano key Weir. So just like last time, I'll be recording this session today. We'll also be sending out copies of our presentation slides. So if you see anything during today's webinar that you want to go back and review, just know that you'll have those materials provided to you after we're finished up. Additionally, if you have any questions or comments that come up throughout the webinar, feel free to contact me at brian.fox@flow3d.com. So today is the second in our 2018 Water and Environmental Webinar Series. So in the last session, we reviewed the basic setup of a free surface problem in Flow-3D, and we used an OG crested weir as our example. So we're going to build on last month's session today by setting up a slightly more complicated problem using a piano key weir geometry. So I'm not going to go into as much detail on the basic setup steps in this webinar, but if you're interested in a more basic overview of our setup process, I'll refer you to last month's session where we reviewed the OG weir setup. So if you sign up for that webinar, you should have received a recording via email. Otherwise, you can still go to our website and download a copy of the recording there. So here's an outline of what we'll be discussing during today's webinar. So we'll start by reviewing exactly what is a piano key weir. After that, we'll take a look at the specific geometry that we'll be setting up in today's example. So we'll be using a simple multi-block meshing configuration during today's setup. So before we get started with the example, let's do a quick review of our multi-block meshing capabilities and also discuss a few of our best practices when using this method. After that, we'll get into the live setup of our piano key weir example. Then after we finish the model setup, we'll take a look at some results from our Flow-3D simulation and compare it with measured data that's derived from a physical modeling experiment. So this is going to allow us to see how well a Flow-3D can validate for a much more complex geometry, such as that of a piano key weir. And then we'll finish up by reviewing some of our recommended best practices for setting up this type of simulation. So just a little bit more about piano key weirs before we get started. So a piano key weir is actually a type of a labyrinth weir. And a labyrinth weir is a class of spillways where the shape of the weir crest is going to have a non-linear as opposed to a linear pattern. And the concept of labyrinth weir is to increase the discharge capacity of the spillway by increasing its effective crest length. So this type of structure might be used in situations where the spillway discharge capacity needs to be increased, but there's going to be some constraints that limit increasing the weir footprint, so we can't actually change its linear length, or there might be constraints on changing the crest elevation, perhaps because of reservoir storage considerations. So a piano key weir, which is shown here on the right, is going to have this simple rectangular shape. And then additionally, we often see a sloped inlet or outlet ramp. And this is going to allow the crest to extend beyond the spillway footprint. And this will ultimately allow for a greater crest length and also overall structure capacity. And so similar to the OG weir, or really any other type of structure that's going to force rapidly varied flow conditions, a typical analysis method would most likely involve using the weir equation, which is going to require an empirically derived discharge coefficient, which is typically obtained from a physical modeling study. So the alternative to this is that we can use Flow-3D to directly simulate these rapidly varied flow conditions and predict discharges over the structure. So in today's webinar, we'll be setting up a piano key weir simulation in Flow-3D. That's based on some experiments that were done by Ricky Anderson at the Utah State University Hydraulics Lab. So photos of the physical model setup are shown here on the slide. And in that study, they performed some experiments to determine the discharge coefficient for different types of piano key weir geometry configurations. So what we're going to be setting up in Flow-3D is going to be based on the physical model geometry corresponding to an inlet-outlet width ratio equal to 1. So what this basically means is that the inlet-outlet width of each piano key cycle is going to be identical. And so if you're interested in more details on the physical model setup, I'll refer you to further reading in the Anderson study, which I have cited here on the bottom of the slide. So here's a look at the finished simulation results after we complete today's setup. So the physical experiments modeled 4 cycles of this piano key weir. And in our numerical simulation, we'll just be modeling a small section or half of a single piano key cycle. So this is going to correspond to about 1/8 of the overall width of the physical model. And the reason that we're setting up our model this way is that we did some initial testing and found that the differences between running a full model versus a section model only varied by a few percent. And so you can see in the graph, we're comparing the discharge of the full model results versus that of a section model multiplied by 8, so we can do a direct comparison. And we can see that the discharges are essentially identical. So based on these tests, we determined that it would be appropriate to just use a section model and extrapolate these results to compare with the full width physical modeling study. And again, that the reason that we're doing this is that it allows us to simplify the model by reducing our domain size, which is going to help us minimize our cell count and also our run times. And so whenever we're starting out a new simulation project, we like to start out as simply as we can and then build complexity from there. And then additional steps in our model setup, we'll be importing an STL file to define our Weir geometry. So this will be similar to how we defined geometry in our last session. And then during the meshing step, it's going to take a little bit more consideration. And this is because we're going to be dealing with a relatively thin wall with this piano key Weir. So we need to make sure that we define our cell sizes so we can adequately resolve these thin walls with our favorite method. So we'll go over all the steps on how we can evaluate that when we're setting up our model. And then lastly, we'll define a multi-block mesh for the section upstream of the Weir. So you can see in the bottom right-hand side of the slide, a diagram showing how we'll be setting up this multi-block mesh configuration. And the reason that we're doing that is that we have this relatively flat and tranquil section upstream, and we don't really need as much resolution up there as we do to resolve the area right around the piano key Weir itself. So this coarser mesh is just another strategy for us to help reduce our cell count and also reduce our simulation run times. So since we'll be using a multi-block mesh in today's setup, I just want to use this as an opportunity to do a quick review of our multi-block meshing capabilities and also our best practices. So in Flow-3D, we have the ability to define multiple mesh blocks that each have their own independent specifications. And we can define these multi-block meshes to be nested, joined, or overlapping. And so with a nested mesh block, which is shown here on the left, we're going to define a refined nested block within a coarser containing block. And the reasons we might want to use a nested mesh block is that it's going to allow us to define a fine mesh resolution in only a small portion of our domain. And so this is going to allow us to better resolve either geometry or a flow solution in our area of interest while keeping other parts of the model at a coarse mesh. So ultimately it's going to allow us to minimize our cell count and also our run times, while still getting that high resolution output where we need it. And then with a joined mesh block, we're going to link two or more mesh blocks by aligning their outer boundaries. And these mesh blocks can either have the same or different mesh resolutions. And the reasons that we might want to define a joined mesh block will be similar to our nested block in that we'll be able to define a finer resolution in one part of our domain. But we can also use these to capture irregular domain shapes and also to define more complex boundary conditions. So for example, if we had multiple outlets or inlets on a single mesh face, we can use multiple join blocks to define these boundaries differently, as opposed to with a single mesh block where we can only define a single boundary condition. And then with overlapping mesh blocks, this is essentially going to be a combination between these two approaches. So when defining multi-block meshes, it's very important to keep in mind some of our recommended best practices to help minimize any error associated with these. So when we have multiple meshes, the solver is going to be passing information between each block. And so each block is essentially going to be used as a source to define boundary condition information for the adjacent mesh block. And so because these meshes are not at the same mesh resolution, it's going to require interpolating data from the source block to define these boundary values for the receiving block. And so to maximize the accuracy of this data transfer procedure, we have a few different recommended best practices. So the first is that we're going to want to use mesh planes to define the interface between these mesh blocks, or define the inner block boundary location. And this is going to ensure that these boundaries of the different blocks align perfectly. And then additionally, if you make any changes to your mesh specification, it's going to make sure that this inner block boundary remains fixed. Second recommendation that we have is we want to try and place these inner block boundaries in locations where there's not major changes in flow conditions. And so it's really best to treat these inner block boundaries just like you would a regular boundary, that you would try and place them at a location far away from your area of interest to try and avoid these boundary effects. And then our third recommended best practice is that we want to try and maintain a 2-to-1 size ratio between two different mesh blocks. And this is going to help ensure convergence of our pressure solution. So if you place your interblock boundaries away from major changes in flow solution, you can get away with a little bit of a larger size ratio. But if you're unsure, you can always do some sensitivity testing to compare the solution for different size or different mesh size transitions. So the last thing that we need to be aware of with multi-block meshes is this issue we refer to as open area mismatch. So because our mesh resolution affects our geometry resolution because of our favor algorithm, the interpretation of geometry can be different at our interblock boundary. So to explain this, I have an example of a cylinder with two joined meshes. And you can see in the image, we have a mesh size transition of 4:1. And you can see we have a much different favor resolution between these two mesh blocks. And so this sudden change in open area can actually cause some numerical problems, particularly with the conservation of mass across its boundary. So decreasing your size transition can certainly help with this, but often this open area mismatch value is really going to depend on the shape of geometry at the boundary. So our recommended best practice for this is just to review the data in our preprocessor summary and make sure that it's within a reasonable magnitude. So to access this information, you'll go to your diagnostics menu, choose preprocessor summary, and then that'll open a text output. If you search mismatch in there, you'll be able to find the values, which I have shown here on the bottom of the slide. So we recommend trying to maintain a value of about less than 5% for this open area mismatch. If you're getting larger values, you might want to monitor the fluid conservation error associated with multi-block meshes, or you may need to go back and actually change the location of your mesh boundary or adjust your cell size transition. And then the last thing I want to point out is that we have a tech note on our user's website that goes into a little bit more detail on how we implement this multi-block mesh method. So if you're interested in more information, you can access that document at the link I've provided here on the bottom of the slide. Okay, so now we'll move over to Flow-3D and start looking at how we set up our Pianoki Weir simulation. All right, so the first thing that we'll want to do is create a new workspace if we don't already have one. And then we'll right click on that workspace and then choose add new simulation. So we'll call this PK setup demo. Then we'll choose okay. And then we can move over to our model setup tab. So just like last time, we'll have these six subtabs and we'll work through each one individually from left to right, starting in general. So the first thing I'll do is set my finish time. So we'll set a value of 30 seconds to get us to a steady state condition. And then I'll leave everything else over here set to default. So we'll leave free surface, one fluid, and then also incompressible defined. And then we'll set our units to SI. So we're not doing any temperature modeling. So again, we can just choose accept to either one of these options. Okay, so that's all we need to do for general. Now we'll move over to the physics tab. And again, this is a basic free surface problem. So all we need to do is define gravity and then also viscosity and turbulence. So to turn on gravity, we'll open our gravity definition and we'll choose -9.81 in the Z direction. Click OK. We'll go to our viscosity and turbulence model. And we'll turn on our viscous flow options and then choose the RNG model with the dynamically computed option. And then we'll click OK there. And now we'll move over to our fluids tab. So we'll expand the properties here, and we'll just need to define properties for fluid number one. So if I right click in here, and I'll choose load material properties, I'll go and find water at 20 degrees C and choose load there. And because we have SI defined in our general tab, it's gonna load it into the proper units. And then we can expand viscosity and density, and we can see we have the proper units set there. Okay, so now moving over to meshing and geometry. And so just like last time, we'll work our way down the left side over here through this toolbar, starting with our geometry options. And we know we have a STL defined for the Pianoki Weir, so we'll click this STL button. And then we're going to choose add and locate where we have that geometry stored on our computer. So pkweir.stl is what we want. We'll choose open. And then I also always like to add this to my simulation folder just to have all the setup files in one location. Then we'll just give the subcomponent a name here. And we'll also be adding this to a new component because it's the first geometry object we're bringing in. So choose OK. For our new component, we'll define it to be a solid, and then I'll give it a name, PK component. We'll choose OK. Okay, so now our geometry has been imported. We can move around, and then we can shift left click anywhere on the surface, and that's going to bring up the coordinates here in the bottom left. So on the bottom of the object, it's a value of -9.75. Top of the object is 0. The x0 location is right around in the center, and then the y0 location is in the center of the object in this direction. And so these units are actually in units of inches. So the physical model was set up and defined using English units, so that's how we drew it in the CAD software. So we could have converted it to SI within CAD, or we can actually just do the conversion here in Flow 3D. So to do that, we'll expand our geometry definition, and then we'll find the subcomponent where we have the STL defined. And then there's going to be some options called transformations. So if I expand these, we have some options for magnification, rotation, and also translation. So if I open this magnification option, we can see we have a global scale factor we can define. So I know that the conversion between inches and meters should be 0.0254, so we'll just enter that value there. And then we can just click the expand view button on the toolbar to refine our object. So now if we shift left click, we can see our units have been changed. So we're now working in SI. All right, so that's all we need to do for our geometry. We could also define a surface roughness, but for this problem, we'll just go ahead and assume it's a hydraulically smooth surface. So we'll just leave that blank and it'll default to a value of 0. Okay, so now we'll define our mesh. So I'll click the mesh button on the toolbar. That's gonna open the meshing widget. So the first thing that I wanna do is create a new mesh. So to do that, we'll click the button at the top of the widget, and it's going to create a new mesh at the origin with dimensions of 1 in each direction. So the first thing that I might want to do is just right-click on mesh block 1, then let's just fit it to geometry to get it close to where it needs to be. And after we do that, we can expand our X, Y, and Z direction mesh planes, and then we can start adjusting our mesh planes to define the domain that we want. So the first thing that I want to do is bring in the lateral dimension, so the Y direction mesh planes, to define the slice of the simulation that we're going to be modeling. So to do that, we'll define a Y min of 0. And then we'll want to bring this other one into the middle of this piano key. So I know from the drawings, that's about 4.6 inches. So we can just enter in a value in metric. I know what that should be as 0.1166185. Okay, so now we can see the slice of the simulation that we're modeling. Then we'll also want to raise the Z elevation of the mesh. So for a Z max, we'll just enter in a value of 0.25 to give room for fluid to move over the top. And then for the bottom of the mesh, I'm just going to raise it up ever so slightly just to make sure that we have a good intersection between the mesh plane and the solid object. So just to make sure that we don't miss that by a decimal point or so. And then for the X direction, we'll expand that to 1. So this is the downstream direction. And then in the X min or the upstream direction, we'll just move it up to -0.6. All right, we're gonna expand the domain further in the X direction, but we're gonna do that with a joined mesh block. And we'll do that after we finish defining everything with this mesh block number 1. Okay, so the next thing that I wanna do is define some mesh planes to make sure we get accurate resolution of the crest of the Weir. So the first thing I wanna do is add a mesh plane to the top here, so in the Z direction. So I right click on Z direction and choose add. And then if I shift left click on top here, it's going to automatically add my coordinate in. I'll choose add. Then we'll add 2 in the X direction. So vertically at the face of the weir, so to pick up this sharp crest. So we'll change our direction to X. Then we're gonna do left shift left click. See our value is added in there. Choose add. We'll also do it for the upstream side. So shift left click, and then our value's been added. All right, and then one last thing I want to do. So just like with the bottom of the mesh, let's bring this Z elevation, let's bring it down ever so slightly, just to make sure that we have a good intersection with the geometry there. Okay. So the next thing that we'll want to do is start looking at the size of our mesh cells. So first, let's turn on our grid lines so we can see what the current setting looks like. And I'm also going to change the color of this so it's easier to see. And let's change the mesh planes to a blue color, and then we'll also just change the interior colors to black. Okay, so it's a little bit easier to see. So looking at this from the side, obviously these cell sizes are much too large for this geometry, so let's just go ahead and set it to a reasonable size. And then we can add a little bit of transparency to our object so we can see the thickness of the walls relative to the size of the mesh cells. So the first thing to note is that when we're dealing with a thin object like this, is we want the cells to actually be smaller than the object itself. What we don't want to do is end up with a situation where we have two faces of a single object within a single cell. So Favor's not going to be able to accurately resolve this object as it is like here. So we want to make sure that these cell sizes, or the diagonal of the cell size, is going to be smaller than the thickness of this object. And so we could calculate this distance by using the thickness of the wall, and then this is also a 30-degree angle here. Or we could just bring this into a CAD software. We can actually just do the measurement to get the proper X, Y, and Z dimensions, so this diagonal is within the thickness of the wall. And so that's what we did, and we know the cell size is about 0.009334. And so when we set that, now we can take a look, and we can see we're not going to have a situation where we're going to have two object faces within a single cell size. So this would be kind of the largest cell size that I would want to go with to make sure that we accurately resolve this thin object. And so we can check the accuracy of that with our favorize tool. So I click the favorize button on our toolbar, and then we choose to favorize component one. I'll click render. Now we can see our favorized geometry, so I'm going to control I to toggle the mesh off, and then let's just turn the transparency off. And now we can see the favorized rendering of our geometry, so that looks pretty good. So if I close my favorized tool, another option that we have to evaluate the quality of our favor method is we can actually just pre-process the simulation and look at the results in the Analyze tab. And so let's go ahead and do that. So we'll go back out to our Simulation Manager tab. And I'm going to right-click on my simulation, and then I'm going to choose this pre-process option. Choose local. And now we can go back to our Analyze tab, and we can look at the results of the preprocessor. So the preprocessor output is going to be this PRPGRF file. So if I open that, and now we can actually look at 2D slices, so we can actually get a little bit, maybe a more accurate view of how exactly Favor is resolving this object. So if I go to my 2D options, and let's take some slices in the X, Z direction, and then we'll choose to show our mesh over top of that. And then, this will be giving us cross sections in the kind of a profile view of the channel. And so we have to choose the location where we want to take it at. So we can actually just choose a single location, or we can just expand all these sliders, and we can get all the cross sections at each one of our mesh cells, which is what I want to do. So once we do that, we'll click render. And now we can zoom in, and we can see exactly how Favor is going to be interpreting this geometry based on the cell size. So let's just skip through each of these cross sections. So all of the different cross sections that are available are going to be located in the viewer here on the right, so we can choose each one. So we can see the Y location of each cross section. You can see we're getting some very good resolution of the geometry here. So our cell size is looking good. So just to kind of show you what to look out for, let's go ahead and favorize this object with a larger cell size. So I'm going to go back to that value of 0.02. And so again, this is a cell size that we know is going to be too large, but again, let's just favorize this just so you have an idea of what to look out for when you're setting up and running a model. So if I render that, turn my mesh off, and now we look at our favorized geometry. Obviously, this is not correct now, so we're not really resolving this object. So we're actually ending up with holes within the Weir itself. So if we ran the simulation with this type of resolution, we'd obviously get some very incorrect results. So we definitely want to avoid this type of situation. Then we can also just go ahead and pre-process this again. Go back to Analyze. Let's reload those results. And we'll render that. So now we can see the favorized version of this larger cell size. So obviously not what we're looking for when we have when we're defining our mesh. So again, I just did that to highlight the importance of making sure that you have an adequate resolution to resolve your geometry objects. Otherwise, you could end up with some simulation results that would not be accurate, which is something we definitely do not want to see. So we'll go back and set our cell size to the value that we want. And that's all we need to do for this first mesh block. So let's go ahead and give it a name too. We'll call it the downstream mesh block. And so now we can create this second mesh block upstream. So again, we're creating a joined mesh block. So we're basically going to be extending this one upstream, but at a coarser resolution, just because we don't really need this fine mesh resolution in an area upstream. So we only really need to make this mesh as fine as it is down here because we need to resolve the geometry. So to do this, we could create a new mesh, and then we could enter in the necessary coordinates. So this upstream mesh face matches the downstream mesh face of mesh block number two. And so we would go through and we enter in each of the X, Y, and Z coordinates for each of the mesh planes. Totally legitimate way to define that, but there's a nice little shortcut for this type of situation. So I can actually just copy mesh block number one. And from the X dimensions, I know it's about 1.6 meters in length, so I can just translate it negative 1.6. And we now have that mesh block that's copied upstream. So let's just go ahead and change the name of that one, call it the upstream mesh block. And then we want to double the cell size too. So we want to make this a coarser mesh just to reduce our cell count. So we can just multiply our size of cells by two. And then we probably don't need these interior mesh planes defined because we're not defining any geometry there. So let's delete those two in the X direction, also the one in the Z direction. Now let's just look at it from the side, and we can see our mesh plane definition. So that's looking good. We can just validate that the coordinates of this mesh face match for the upstream and downstream. So you can see we have an X direction mesh plane of negative 0.6 in the upstream side there, negative 0.6 in the downstream side for mesh block number two. Then also our Y and Z mesh planes match what we have in mesh block number one. So definitely what we want to see when we're using joined mesh blocks. Okay, so that's all we need to do for our mesh setup. Next, we're going to define our boundary conditions. So I'll click the BC button. And so when I open this boundary condition window, you can see we now have options to define boundaries at each of the faces of both mesh blocks. And sometimes when you start adding a lot of different mesh blocks, it can be kind of difficult to figure out which of these boundaries go with which face on your mesh. So a nice option to do this visually is we can just hit this BC button on our toolbar, and we can manually define or pick out the boundaries that we want to edit. So for mesh block number two on the upstream side, I can edit this by just clicking the S defining the boundary at that location. Likewise, I can get to the same information by just clicking X-Men Unmesh 2 boundaries. So really just depending, you know, what's easier for you for a particular simulation. So for this simulation, I want to define my upstream boundary to be a volume flow rate. So in our last setup, we defined an upstream boundary to be a total hydraulic head, and we calculated the discharge over the weir. In this simulation, we'll define the volume flow rate, and then we'll calculate the upstream hydraulic head. So you can do that either way. It really just depends on the type of data you have available and what information you're trying to get. So for this one, we'll define, again, this X-Min in mesh block 2, and I'm going to set it to a volume flow rate. And we'll define that to be a value of 0.02732. And then for this option here on the right, we need to define the elevation of where the fluid is going to come in at. So if we leave this set to fluid fraction, it's going to distribute fluid over the entire face of the mesh. Or we can choose fluid elevation. That's going to limit the top of the fluid. So we'll set that to a value of 0.1654. And we'll click OK. So the fluid elevation at the inlet for this particular simulation is not particularly important. So you can imagine we're going to have a critical flow over the weir. So we're going to have a subcritical backwater profile upstream. So the elevation at the inlet is actually going to be controlled by what's occurring downstream in the domain. So no matter what we set within the first few cells, it should adjust to the conditions downstream. So we went ahead and set an elevation that's pretty close to what it should be. But again, it'll go ahead and adjust as the fluid, it'll adjust on its own as the fluid enters the domain. Okay, so for our downstream boundary, last time we defined this as a subcritical tailwater. So we're going to set a supercritical outlet for this particular simulation. And we have three different options on how we can define that. So we can define it to be a continuative boundary, an outflow, or a specified pressure with a fluid fraction equal to zero. So I typically like to use the specified pressure with fluid fraction equal to zero. So that's going to correspond to the physical condition of a free discharge into the atmosphere. And then likewise, we're going to set our top boundaries using the same method. So specified pressure with fluid fraction equal to zero. And then for our bottom boundary, so the Z-min, we're going to set that to a wall boundary. So that's going to act as a hydraulically smooth, no-slip surface. And then for our side boundaries, we're going to leave those set to symmetry. So that'll act as a free-slip surface, which would be appropriate for this particular situation where we're just modeling a slice of the simulation. And then the last boundary we have is this interblock boundary. And so anytime we have an interblock boundary, the solver is automatically going to reset this to an interblock type. So really, no matter what you define this to be, it's going to be rewritten by the solver to handle that interblock boundary condition. So we don't really need to define anything for this interblock location. Okay, so that's all we need to define for our boundary conditions. So the next thing that we'll do is define our initial conditions. And so for initial, we'll define a fluid elevation within the domain just to help it get to steady state a little faster. So let's make sure we define hydrostatic pressure for a pressure distribution. And then we'll define a fluid region to fill the domain. So let's open our limiter options. I'll define an X high to be zero. And then my Z high to correspond with my upstream boundary, that'll be 0.1654. Okay, so that's all we need to do for our initial conditions. And then lastly, we'll just define a device where we can monitor the upstream hydraulic head. And we'll do that by placing a flux plane. And so let's add a flux plane upstream of the weir. Let's add it at a location of negative 0.8. And with this flux plane, we'll activate a variable called total hydraulic head 3D. And what that's going to do is it's going to calculate a variable or total hydraulic head value using the local pressure and also local velocity at each cell within the domain. And so when we have that active, then we also create a flux plane. It's going to calculate a value for the flux plane that's a flux averaged or a discharge averaged value for this total hydraulic head over the flux plane. So it gives you a good cross-sectional average of the total hydraulic head. Okay, so once we have that defined, we're done with our model setup or our meshing and geometry at least. And we'll move over to our output tab. And so for restart data, we'll leave that set to default. So we'll get restart data at intervals of 3 seconds since this is a 30-second simulation. For our selected data, we'll leave that interval also set to default. And then for additional output, let's make sure we check total hydraulic head data 3D. And then we'll also make sure we check that in our selected data, and we'll also choose our fluid velocities. So that's all we need to do for our output tab. Then numerics, we'll just leave everything here set to default. Then after we do that, we can go back to Sim Manager and we can hit Control S to save. Then we'll right click and choose Run Simulation. Okay, so the preprocessor will, once that finishes running, solver starts, and so it'll take about an hour or so to finish running. So while that's running, let's go ahead and take a look at some results. So instead of looking at these results in our Analyze tab, we'll open up FlowSight and take a look at our results there. Okay, so the first thing that I want to do once I open FlowSight is open my results file. So I can do that by clicking this button at the top left. And then when we have this window open, we can actually click this button here to show our portfolio in Flow-3D. So we'll look at the PK Weir results. And we'll select PK Weir demo results there. And we'll click OK to open it. And we'll be able to see our results so we can navigate around. So the first thing I want to point out is on the left side here, we have different lists where we can activate and deactivate different types of objects. So we have our geometry list, so we can turn on our STL components. And then we also have our baffles that we can turn on. So I'm just going to go ahead and change the color of the STL, color that gray. And then we have different mesh objects. We can turn those off. And then we have this ISO surface object. So by default, whenever we open simulation in FlowSight, it's going to create this ISO surface of the fluid itself. So we can color that by velocity or really any other variable that we have within Flow-3D. And we can also add a little transparency so we can see what's going on inside the fluid. Then we can zoom in and take a closer look. So everything's looking good there. And then the other thing that we can do is we can change the time that we're looking at. So by default, the results get imported as the final time step. But if we go to the top left here, we can see our time display functions. We can actually move this slider further back in time. We can actually just move it back to time equals zero. And then we can just click this play button. It's going to automatically step through the different time steps. So I hit pause, and then we'll just move this back to our final time step. And then we also wanted to take a look at this total or this flux average hydraulic head from this upstream flux plane. And with any of our measurement device data, we can typically access that through the general history probe tab in our analyze tab in Flow-3D. And we can also access that directly in FlowSight by clicking this red history data button. So when we click that, this brings open all of the different history data that we have available. So I'm going to choose flux surface 1, flux average hydraulic head. I'm going to add that to a new plot. And we'll see that plotted on the screen here. Okay. Then we can actually do some things to modify the plot. So if I want to change my axes, the min and max. So let's just set that to 0. And we also have some options to change how this displays and also how we annotate each of the axes and also the title. We'll just leave that set to default for now. Okay, so that's what our results look like. So now let's go back to the PowerPoint and let's take a look at how some of our simulation results actually compare to physical modeling data. Okay, so now let's look at how Flow-3D results actually compare with the physical modeling data from Anderson 2011. So on the slide here, we have two plots. We have one of discharge values of flow over the weir as a function of our upstream total hydraulic head. And then the second plot on the right, we have a calculated discharge coefficient as a function of total hydraulic head over weir height. And so the black line on the plots represent data from the Anderson 2011 study. And then the red points represent our Flow-3D simulation results. So the first thing to note is that we're getting excellent agreement between the Flow-3D and also the physical modeling results. So typically, we're seeing differences in the range of 2 to 4% between the numerical and also the measured data. And so that's using the same set of procedures that we used in the live demo, which is going to include all of our default numerical options. So we also tested different types of physical modeling options, and that's going to include different turbulence models and also values of maximum turbulent mixing length. Then we also tested differences in our numerical options that include our volume of fluid methods, our second order momentum advection options, and also our pressure solver convergence criteria. However, the only thing that really resulted in a significant improvement to the solution was the mesh resolution. And so we found that further refining the resolution of flow over the crest of the weir is going to be the main factor that's going to help us improve our simulation results. So on the left, we can see the same flow rate defined for different resolutions of the mesh. And on the right, we can see general trends for the reduction of the percent error in our solution as we further increase that mesh resolution of flow over the weir. So for this particular simulation, we started out with a fairly small cell size, and that was because of the requirements of favor with the thin weir walls. So even with the largest cell size that we tested, we're still getting really good results, typically in the range of less than 4%. But further refining that mesh is gonna further increase our accuracy within a few percent of the measured data. And at this point, we're starting to approach the uncertainty of the experimental data itself. So I'll finish up today by summarizing some of our recommended best practices for this type of simulation. So first, with our multi-block meshes, we want to keep in mind that the three best practices we talked about earlier in the presentation. So we want to make sure that we locate mesh planes at the inner block boundaries. Then we define the location of these interblock boundaries to be in areas where the flow solution does not have significant changes. Then we also want to try and maintain a 2-to-1 size ratio between adjoined mesh blocks. Next, for the weir simulation, we found that the most critical aspect of the setup is going to be the mesh cell size. So first we need to define that maximum cell size so we'll accurately resolve the thin walls of the piano key weir. And then we also want to use mesh planes to define the sharp features of the crest itself. So these two things are going to make sure that we maximize the accuracy of our favor method. Then next, from our own testing, we recommend a range of 4 to 8 cells to resolve the depth of flow over the weir. So given a mesh resolution of 5 cells over across the nape for our current simulation, we found that all solutions resulted in an accuracy between 2.5% to 3.5%. As compared with the experimental results. And again, we can further improve that accuracy by further refining the mesh. For our physical modeling options, we found that the choice of turbulence model and also the defined maximum turbulent mixing length had very little effect on the discharge calculations. So because of that, we recommend using our RNG model with a dynamically computed mixing length option, but really any of the other RANS models should be suitable for this application. We also recommend using our default numerical options. So we tried using our second order momentum advection options and generally found these actually decrease the accuracy, along with adding additional computational expense because it's a higher order method. So the first order options actually produce the best results and really should be suitable for these types of flows. We also did some testing of the split and unsplit Lagrangian volume of fluid methods and found that the default volume of fluid method to actually outperform both of these. And then lastly, we also did some testing of our of running different simulations with an increased pressure solver convergence criteria. And we actually found these to not produce any significantly different results, and also resulted in an increased computational expense. So again, for all of our default numerical options, actually produced the best results. And then lastly, we have a bibliography on our website where we list various types of journal publications and conference proceedings. So I mentioned this during the last session. So again, you can access that that page through the link I provided at the top of the slide. I've also copied over some of the references where people have modeled labyrinth and piano key weirs with Flow-3D. So if you're interested in modeling these types of structures in practice, I'd recommend that you take a look at some of these references we have listed here. So that's all we have for today. I just want to thank everyone for attending. I hope you found all this information helpful. Additionally, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to contact me at brian.fox@flow3d.com. Also, feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn, where I'll be posting some information on future webinars. And then next month, we'll start looking at how we can actually model fish passages in Flow-3D. So if you haven't already signed up for that, I recommend that you go check that out on our website. So with that, I just want to say thanks again to everyone for attending, and we'll see you next time.